Well, I've always I've seen so much injustice, not just in Germany, but here when I first came here and I saw how black people were treated, I could not believe it. And I think this is when I became an activist. I was only 11 years old when I came here. But I think I've always been a rebellious soul. But the dissonances, I think, have always been there, and I think it has a lot to do with a mother who was a... She was really an anti-mother. she was dreadful, yeah. And my father was a doctor, and he... when I was a child, he was a wonderful father. But, you know, the war that was going on constantly in my house, in my home, I think that there was a kind of protest against that also. It's very hard to trace sometimes exactly what has formed you. But I think all of these things come together. And I know during the Vietnam thing, I was a high school teacher, and it was my kids, my students, when they were 18, they were drafted, and then they came home in body bags. And it was my students and my, you know, the kids that I had really formed an attachment to. And that was hard to take. So I took my little kids at that time, on every one of the marches, and in New York, and in sometimes in Washington. And, I mean, it sort of got me started in my protest. And then, you know, when I found what I found in Africa, how can you not protest? How can you not pick this up? And I've been asked of what has kept you doing this for 30 years? Well, once you dedicate yourself to it, you can't stop. You can't say, well, I've done enough now. Until it's over. When it's over, that's when I quit, not before. Nothing. Nothing at all. This was something that I found out about from... I was in a hostel of some sort, and there was an American black there who had traveled a lot through Africa. And he told me about it, and I said, oh my God, that must be only in the bush somewhere, back, you know, desert settlements, really ignorant people. No, he said, every woman in this city has been done this way. And I said, well, can you talk to people about it? And he said, oh no, they won't tell you anything. But then it occurred to me that he was a man, and of course they wouldn't talk to him about it. But then finally I found myself in a situation with some educated Sudanese, and this one man, he was brilliant. He had really taught himself how to speak English. And he had been an honor student, and so had his wife. And so I said, well, Mohammed, can I ask you something? And if it's something that you cannot talk about, then please just forgive that I've asked it, and we'll never speak of it again. And then I said, I had to phrase it just right, you know. And what I said was, I would like to know what happens when it comes the girl's time to be cut. And I will never forget what happened in this man's face. There was suddenly such great pain in his face. And his wife was sitting there nursing their baby. And he said, ask this woman, she has suffered this thing. And obviously, he loved her very much. And then we began to talk about it. And they wrote out letters of recommendation of people that I could ask, you know, either lawyers or doctors or judges or holy men, I mean, everything. And they wrote out the letters, and I've never had much luck in finding those people, but I would show the letters to, so that somebody would perhaps guide me to the right person, and they would answer my questions. And after a while, I found out I didn't even need the letters. I just let them look into my face and my eyes, and they could see that I was honest, and that I was trying to help. And I got all the information that I needed from everybody. It was amazing how, you know, just if you just left yourself open. And very often women thanked me, and I, after having given me their stories, and I said, why are you thanking me? Because you are here with your own body, and because you care about us. So, you know, it was something that evolved, sort of, and I began to ask more and more questions, and after about 7 months, it got too hot in Khartoum, so I had to leave. I went back through Europe, selling my story, through all of Europe, by the way. And then eventually I came back again to the Sudan, and I would have more questions, because I would think about it in the interim and say, this is what I still have to find out. And then I'd pursue that, a different line, you know, of inquiry. And it was, actually, I had 4 journeys during those 6 years. And in Sudan, it was very easy. In Kenya, it was impossible to get any information, because there it's tied to politics. And, well, Kenya is a strange place anyway. They've had it up to here with people asking them questions and butting into their most intimate personal business and never giving anything back to them, just taking, taking, taking. But it kind of, everything evolved. And then, of course, I was also able to, once I stopped traveling after 6 years, I actually traveled. I backpacked through Africa alone, which sometimes I really wonder, oh my God, where did I find the courage to do that? Was it dangerous sometimes? Yes, of course it was dangerous sometimes. But I don't know, that didn't seem to bother me. Well, I did, and, you know, occasionally I was scared, but that didn't stop me. You know, and I think the only difference between a courageous person and one that is not courageous is that the courageous person is afraid but keeps going. You know, you don't stop because of your fear. You just try to protect yourself and do your best to still just keep on going. And then, of course, you know, once you accumulate all of this knowledge, you have to share it. Well, I'm 82 years old now, and I'm in very good physical condition. But, you know, the blood pressure climbs up occasionally. And if I kick off tomorrow, it'll be okay, because I will have lived a life that was worth living. I did something with my life. And that is the important thing. Do something with your life that is of benefit, rather than just letting it go.